My name is Othmar Lehmann. I am, as the slide here says, responsible in MindSphere R&D for developing the platform core and the connectivity elements of the platform. So I'm basically, most of the people who speak here are from the product management side. I'm one of the guys in the background who constantly works on making all this a reality from a software side and making sure that it's operated in a way that you guys are happy with it. So MindSphere is a platform of fairly sizable scale. Actually, MindSphere is, of course, at its core not a platform, it is an ecosystem, but it is an ecosystem that is powered by software. So in the end, even though it is an ecosystem, if the software is not specified, implemented, and also operated, then this whole thing does not get off the ground. So software development at large scale used to be, I would say, not so easy. In the last, I would say, decade or so, agile methods have made everything way easier. So if we think about it, software engineering has become way easier over the last years with the introduction of agile development method, particularly Scrum. According to a new Bitkom study, just about everyone, about 80% of companies, software companies within Germany endorse Scrum as a working method on an agile level and find this very helpful. Scrum is fine, Scrum is perfect and solves a lot of issues and is especially easy if you have a small and overseeable team, preferably two pizza teams, you know that from AWS. The teams have to be co-located, you have one product with that one product owner can specify. You have kind of not a 20-year of legacy you are talking about, and you have a limited amount of external dependencies for your product. With this, it becomes easier, and Scrum solves a lot of problems. Unfortunately, sometimes it's a little bit more complex, and it gets more complex, especially if you have a larger number of applications that somehow need to work together, maybe as part of a bigger platform. If you have a large organization, so if you are not talking about 10 people, but maybe 1,000 people, 1,000 software engineers collaborating in order to create a platform, when you have an open ecosystem where it's not like you do not control everything that happens, but where in fact you are your development organization has interactions to the outside, and when you are talking about also really large systems. So thinking about this, actually, if we talk about MindSphere, MindSphere is a fairly sizable endeavor. So it is an ecosystem at its core that is designed to make you successful, but underneath of it, this is most of it is driven by software. Kathleen already showed you the basis of the architecture. The focus of my talk is not so much about, I would say, technical details or what technologies we use, but how we try or how we organize this so that it all comes together with regular releases in a DevOps model to continuously provide new functionalities for you. So this is a little bit, I mean, we have in over 50 locations, we have about 20, we have at about 50 locations, we have 20 MindSphere application centers. We have a lot of Scrum teams, about 1,000 developers that work on the system every day. They are on a lot of continents distributed through a lot of time zones. So this is a, in order to deliver a ecosystem for basically, yeah, most of the verticals that Siemens serves. How to bring this together? So I collected here, and this is just a selection of some of the important, I would say, success factors or topics we think about in our development organization every day. So and this I will talk about here, development efficiency and industrial-grade DevOps as one piece of the puzzle, then providing the right slicing and dicing your product correctly and providing the right building blocks and managing accordingly. Strategic development and architecture management, obviously, software ecosystems and openness, and operations and monitoring and validation and quality assurance. This sounds terribly dry. I mean, who here gets excited when he reads this? Okay, well, actually, I get excited when I read through this, but it, in fact, is a little bit dry. So let's try something else. ever played a concert in an industrial setting? And what does this have to do with music? Well, let's try to play this along a music analogy. So let's get started. So if you want to play a concert, what do you need? You do need a good band, and you do not need a decent band yet, but you need to be the best band. You need guys who really know their stuff playing the instruments. You do need here the guys on the drums, maybe not always the most popular member of the band, but he drives everything that is going on. You need the band lead who makes sure that, who basically controls what is going on. You need to provide the right performance on stage, otherwise no one is going to pay for your tickets. You need a fantastic sound engineering guy, sound and light engineers, so the guy sitting over here, who make sure that, first of all, they always hear what the sound is like, and they provide the appropriate feedback to the band so that they can play accordingly. So easy, isn't it? Well, getting a little bit more in detail what this analogy means for software. So, software ecosystems and openness. It all begins with having the right guys on the, at the instrument, so having the right band. You need the best people with the right skills. MindSphere is basically using right now the hottest technologies on the market with the most recent architectures. So all cloud platform based on microservice architecture with all the, I would say, hot and cool hot technologies, the cool technologies, and all the thing that looks good on the resume. So it's not so easy to get the right people with the right skill set. So we decided to look all over the world for the best people for that. So I can only recommend to go with a partner that is able to get the right resources if you don't have a corporate background like we at Siemens, where we have fairly good methods for recruiting and getting the best people on board. The foundation of the success is the individual development team. So as you can imagine, if we have about 1,000 people working on the software, we structured them in scrum teams. So basically the whole development is structured in individual scrum teams. Each scrum team has the responsibility for a number of microservices that are where they have complete ownership about. So they define them, they architect them, they implement them, they test them, they deploy them, they operate them, and they support them. And as I will talk about later, as we use a DevOps approach, it's not only that they, like in traditional senses, where one guy implements, throws over the fence, someone else has the best of luck in operating this. In our approach, you build it, you run it, and if your services crash at 2 a.m., then you will get the call at 2 a.m., and you will get up, and you will get the things working again. So ownership for the team, but also enablement for the team. You need to empower them. So only telling someone that now he's responsible, but he cannot decide anything, in the end is not going to work. So the challenge here, and this has been addressed before, especially by Kathleen, is to find the right balance between, on one hand, enabling the team and giving them freedom to decide, and on the other hand, to steer them and to give them guidance and governance with respect to architecture. And I will get into this when I talk about architecture later. This is, if you are coming from more traditional kinds of R&D management, a bit of a daunting thing, where you say, okay, those guys are responsible for their own fate, and they need to deliver, but what happens if they don't? Well, the point is, this is the new kind of R&D management. So in an agile environment, you need to delegate to the teams, you need to empower the teams, otherwise you cannot manage projects of the scale in a top-down and purely centralized approach. And as I said, the teams should be responsible, or have to be responsible for the whole life cycle. Because this only if they feel the responsibility for the whole life cycle, they will architect and implement it, especially quality control in a way that in the end makes you as customers happy. Good, next topic, development efficiency. How to organize, how to drive it. So what is the rhythm that we play to, the rhythm we work according to? As I said, Scrum as a basis. So we are using, I mean, Scrum is, you all know Scrum. We work on 2-week sprint cycles, which at the end of each sprint, we have shippable software for each service. We do regular releases. So and teams can independently decide which release train they want to be part of. So they can say they can release every 2 weeks, or they can decide to only release at a slower cadence, depending on their individual needs. The idea there is, again, not a central, complete command of and control what's going on in the individual team level, but empowering the teams and providing them the release trains they can board to bring software to the market. So one very important thing here is this cyclical work, so in 2-week sprint cycles, and allows you to give very, very short feedback cycles. So if something goes wrong, like every 2 weeks you have completely integrated software, shippable software, also deployed software on various environments. So if there's anything not going right, you find out the latest every 2 weeks. And this is, I think, at the core of agility and at the core of if you want to control risk in a project like this, to avoid surprises. And if something fails, the principle of fail fast. So every 2 weeks we find out whether it works or whether it doesn't. Next topic, provide the right building blocks. So if you bring the wrong stuff on stage, then you can play perfectly, but if no one likes the song, then that won't help you in the end. So building blocks, Kathleen DeVorg, our chief architect, already talked about building blocks, the way we use microservice architecture to basically structure this from a technical level. The one thing I want to point out is my very strong advice is to structure your development activity along your business requirements. This sounds fairly straightforward. If we look at this, I mean, you probably know these pictures of, I would say, different parts of the MindSphere ecosystem. Some of them are very clear technology heavy. So for example, if you look at core services, there is a list of services under that that we support. Other of them, like for example, partner services, have the occasional software associated with it, but are mostly business functions. So we have organized our development in a way that each product owner is part of one of those functions and basically directly interacts with the business there. And also the teams are basically always work into one of those business functions. This has a big advantage. First of all, it's good to get the right requirements. So it's good to be very business-driven, very customer-focused, because everything comes here from the market. The other plus is it creates accountability, because you can also control your cost, like your development cost, your infrastructure cost, all based on basically your offering. So which also helps a lot to align your development activities with, in the end, your business success. Good. Next topic, operations and monitoring. And to give you a quick spoiler, you will have the opportunity tomorrow to hear a talk of 30 minutes of Bobby. So Jamie Florence, who is our global head of operations for MindSphere. And this is, I can tell you, a riveting story of bringing all this together and operating this to a lot of nines. So we have a lot of nines in our SLAs and how to run this. So Kathleen told you how this is architected for availability. Bobby is going to tell you how this is operated for this high availability. And I would like to give you some pointers about how to organize your development for that. One topic is, as I already mentioned, the DevOps approach. So incentivizing the individual developer for availability. And the best incentive is not a bonus or some target for the year, but the fact that he does not want to get up at 2 a.m. at night because his service failed. So if you set it up like this, where you build it, you run it, this already helps immensely. The next topic, and this I want to point out specifically, is the relevance of monitoring. Because as Kathleen already told you, everything fails always. So you always have to assume that your services will fail at some point. We have architected for resilience, but still issues like individual service irregularities can occur. And the challenge is to recognize them before they become noticeable for the customer. So for that, monitoring is really important. And monitoring should not be an afterthought, but you should already, from the beginning, create the appropriate infrastructures and also make the teams aware to provide the right kind of data. Good. But this mostly, I mean, operating this is extremely thrilling. It's an interesting story. And so tomorrow, Bobby can give you a very good overview. So almost last but not least, validation and quality assurance. Quality for a platform like this is absolutely paramount. I mean, we are not talking about consumer here. We are talking about a platform for industry. And so there can be no discussion about the demands for quality. We have organized our testing activities along the testing pyramid, where you have at the bottom, it starts with the development-led unit tests and through various levels. NFR tests, API tests, integration tests, up to end-to-end testing at the top. Here, the one thing or the one hint I would like to give you is to push quality as much close to the developer as you can. So in MindSphere, we have organized it in a way that the developers also test their code, and all testing is automated. So it is all the developers are also implementing their own testing automation for the code they develop. We, in some teams, use test-driven development, whereas we haven't rolled that out broadly. There we have some flexibility how the individual teams want to drive this. But push quality as low, as close to the developer as possible. Don't make it someone else's problem. Quality and the fact that the code is running needs to be every developer's individual interest. Yes, automation is your friend. I mean, as always in cloud platforms and with DevOps approaches, automation, I mean, everything you do manual, you can already say is not going to scale. You might be able to do it manually in the beginning, and maybe it works if you have a deployment once every 2 months, and maybe it works if you have a deployment only to one region. But as soon as your stuff scales out, so you want to really do continuous delivery, you want to have a production deployment every 2 weeks, maybe every week, every day. If you have to do everything you do and need to do manual, there is basically killing you. So invest in automation, especially testing automation, deployment automation. So automation is your friend. And testing is in no way, I mean, in traditional enterprise software development, testing is more, I would say, application domain driven and not so much a development task. In this environment, testing is an extremely highly qualified development task. So this is, just be aware that you need the right people to do this. Next topic, we use automated gates, so quality gates as part of our pipelines. So we have, for example, static code analysis and our testing automation included in our pipelines. So although we do trust our developers, we do governance through pipelines. So the idea is to also in the, for example, for reviews, do less. Of course, we also do manual code reviews, but not only to do, like to come in and do a manual review of something, but instead through your automation, roll out governance. Kathleen talked about DevSecOps and the kind of security testing we do as part of our automated pipelines. We also run our testing automation as part of our pipelines and make sure that nothing gets promoted accidentally to the next environment unless it meets our quality objectives. And then one thing I wanted to point out is the whole topic of NFR engineering. Cloud platforms of this scale have extremely complex interactions from a non-functional requirement perspective. And sometimes the behavior under load, if you have so many services collaborating, is not straightforward. So set up an NFR engineering team, drive top-down your market requirements to the individual team level, and then test it on the way up on the individual team level for NFR fulfillment, but also on the end-to-end level. Good, and now I can say, last but not least, strategic development and architecture management. So like the band lead, who basically is driving this show. And there, I want to talk about two things. So first of all, how to bring this all together. I mean, a lot of people are working on this. A lot of people continuously create functionality that somehow needs to come together to form a coherent platform. We are using to bring one key aspect of bringing this together is our API management approach. So I mean, you guys mostly consume our APIs. So we have a very stringent process in place to manage our APIs. We have managed the lifecycle of our APIs and hold them stable for quite a long time. And basically, we use our, that's what they say, you use your own medicine. So we also use internally the same API lifecycle management process, where we say APIs get specified, APIs get reviewed, APIs get approved, APIs get implemented, APIs get tested, and then they are held stable. And this is basically the way you handle most of your dependencies. So we continuously, what we offer you, we also use internally. So this helps tremendously. The other topic is architecture. And I already told you that the teams are very responsible for their for their individual services. So they define them, they architect them, they implement them, and so on. But if they are responsible for architecting them, they need the skills to do that. So we have decided to invest in providing a dedicated architect to each development team, which is not so easy. It's not, people with that skill set are not easy to find. We have an intensive internal also skilling program. We run intensive certification programs for our architects, and architects are an interesting career path within MindSphere research and development. So software is never finalized, and creating software is a learning experience. What Kathleen already said in her presentation, I mean, the software you're running now won't be the software you will be running in 6 months or within 2 years. The idea is not to be to do the impossible and make a future-proof plan for the next 3 years, but instead to create software that can be changed and not to be afraid to continuously evolve your software. We have come up with architectures that allows us on one hand to do this, but on the other hand to keep your APIs, your interfaces, stable. Good, and I think, like in all good concerts, if you do it right, it can be a lot of fun, and it is a lot of fun. It is one of the, I would say, all the biggest adventures, and I would say it's a tremendous experience to be part of, and that is the development of MindSphere. Good, so much from my side.
Thank you so much, Othmar. Maybe we can give him a round of applause.